Bonjour à
Good
tous
morning,
à
everybody.
Merci
Thank you for being here for this presentation on responsible food offers. I'm Pauline Pingusson. I'm the joint manager of Graines de Changement, a positive information agency that also wants to be an idea and innovatory solution laboratory for sustainable development. And among the activities that we've developed to boost some subjects to consumers and professionals, we've published, the last of 2016, we published this small study about 100% responsible offers, which is a survey of choice editing in France. Has anybody here heard of choice editing? Do you know what it is, choice editing? Never? No? You've never heard of it? Okay. That's good, because now I'm going to tell you everything about it. And this, you can find this study in free access in microspolaplanet.com, which is a laboratory, an observatory, sorry, for responsible consumption, with lots of information and tips about how to choose alternative, responsible alternatives for the consumer. And but professionals, also people from the trade, also come to look at this site to get information and documentation about responsible consumption. This trace editing. This is the first publication in a series that we call Nectractis. Nectractis means that we want to look at emerging practices. That's why it's next rather than best practices. We talk about best practices, but we're trying to get ahead of things and talk about next practices. We're trying to look at the low-level signals that we need to work on. And this publication is not so much an academic publication in the strict sense of the word, but it's rather opening up a window on the emerging subjects that we want to look at and to share with you. Today, the trace editing that we've translated into French by Sélection Positive, we've tried to think about different questions to how to approach this subject. We've got three key questions. The first is trying to know how to go beyond current limits to responsible consumption, because figures show us that we're on a kind of a flat moment at the moment in terms of sales of products and services that could be called responsible. So how can we get beyond this flattening out effects and go to engage and mobilize critical masses for or against sustainable development, and not just the hardcore of people already convinced, how to get crowds into this subject. The other question, another question was, we wondered about the tools that would help us to make scale changes and also impact a greater number on this market. And also, the third question was wondering about whether the solution might be in the offer and not in demand. This led us to what was really our leitmotif with this quotation from André Ford, which said that if he'd listened to his customers, he would have given them a horse rather than a car. So if we listen, maybe it's not enough to go and boost new emerging markets and subjects. Okay, so choice editing, what are we talking about? What are the three levers to help us to do choice editing, or positive selection, as we call it in French? First of all, we've got this lever, which is to eliminate progressively but completely all the products that are not virtuous. So what do we mean by non-virtuous products? It's also a question of terminology. These are products for lowest price, not necessarily wonderful quality. Maybe their traceability is not clear. So what do we call responsible or virtuous products? The best way of finding out is to look at the labels, the certifications, the guarantees as often as possible, trying to buy independent labels to preserve the neutrality of the specifications and auditing process. You might have organic products or free trade products or red label, Le Blanca, or French guaranteed origin, GPC, local products directly from the producers. The best way of knowing how the product has been manufactured is to ask the person who made it. And the main idea is to have a wide range of choices of what we might mean by responsible products, and trying to broaden this responsible choice, but at the same time limit the an offer which is not responsible. So the second point is to make some products less accessible, because if some products, we're going to look at them, in fact, the ones that are less virtuous, and we're going to see how we can make them less accessible by different levers, for example, price. That's the last signal. So adapt the price signal by making the least virtuous or responsible products more expensive, because obviously the products which are less virtuous do have an environmental, social, and economic cost. And if that's not reflected in the price, who is going to absorb it? So we're going to try and put back the responsibility on the to the manufacturer and the supplier and the industrials and the professionals, but also the consumer with this price signal. And that also helps us to orient their choices. And this another thing could be to make these products less accessible in a physical way. In the shelves, you know that the ones that are up at the top or down at the bottom are going to be less seen by the consumer, so you've got less likely to be chosen. That sounds silly, but it is an existing lever. And the last example, which we'll illustrate later in more depth, is that products that are not a free service, for example, not to put them on physical sales outlets, but on internet, just to make them less accessible in the point of sale. Does everyone understand? Are you lost? Ask me any questions. React if you like as we go along. Yes, yes. Is there a microphone for the questions? Yes, about. And maybe my presentation might answer your question. When I listen to you, it's like you're policing a thought. It's like she can't hear, apparently. I can. When I listen to you, I'm a bit worried, because it's like you're policing our thought. You're decreeing what's virtuous, what's not virtuous. You're making products less accessible, and I don't understand your criteria. How can you make them less accessible? Who does it? Is it it's the person who sells them? So is it the distributor that's going to make them more difficult to access? Yes. The later part of my presentation will answer your questions. Your question, both the questions are interesting, because I take it from the opposite point of view. Why shouldn't the person who sells them decide whether it's virtuous or not virtuous? It's true. There's lots of ethical and moral questions here. So it is a strong term to use, virtuous. This presentation will open up discussion. The idea is not to be dogmatic, but to give keys and inspirations to people that want to go down this road. Obviously, there's all the implications. And to ask the questions before, instead of being confronted with the questions actually on the day, being confronted with regulations or bans or nationally or internationally, which might push us and our practices and our choices from consumers and professionals who sell the products and services might push them in a certain direction. So positive selection, is this a tool to democratize responsible consumption? This presentation could be sent out to the show organizers if you want access. Don't hesitate to take any photos that you want to, and you will have access to the whole presentation and also the report, which will be free to access on the site. So as we start to think about these questions, we can see that the green product ranges are faced with failure in terms of sales figures. We realize that what we call Gambet's green or organic food, to respond to these issues, are often products that are not really supported by marketing departments. And the only argument of just sustainability is not necessarily going to include using the right, the same criteria as conventional products, such as efficiency, price, etc. Which means that we have marketing teams that are not always very motivated. So how can they sell them if they're not convinced themselves? And the marketing messages often address people who already believe in this cause of a sustainable and responsible consumption. So how to get out of this small hardcore of people that are already convinced in order to go to the critical mass of people? And Here we have products which just talk about the sustainable and economically responsible products without necessarily drawing your attention to other criteria such as efficiency and price, which are existing criteria. To do this, we interviewed two people for our study because we looked at what was being said, what was being written on this subject of choice editing in French, in France and overseas. And we looked at experts and fairly varied. And the former president of the CLCV explained that generalization of the sustainable consumption is the power of purchase of the consumer. That's an important criteria. And we realize if we don't have a price which is logical but which is accessible for these responsible products, people were not going to be convinced, and they'll never buy them if they're too expensive. And the sales will never, figures will never take off. Eric Fouquier of Tema says that low price is a lever to transform the world, and we need to use it to make food products accessible to the masses. And this is a real objective. How can we reach this objective? One of today's solutions is labels, certifications, guarantees, etc. These represent part of the answer, but not the whole answer. And so the problem with these labels is that it's kind of like a jungle, and we're going to choose between the beauty and the beast, the good, the bad, and the ugly label. And the consumer society and modern society, we need to reach them with impact. And you've got, for example, you're a couple in front of a meat range, saying to the wife, saying to husband, have we really taken into account all the family, environmental, and geopolitical issues to buy this? It's kind of a dichotomy between all the work that the consumer needs to do, if they want to go look for the information. Is this information right? Is it relevant? And is it adaptable to the person's daily life? And the reality is that, no, you're in front of a range of products and you don't know what to do. And the consumer finds it difficult to know where they're at in this problem. And the other thing is, you can see somebody reading a label saying, okay, if you buy this product, you will favorize the disappearance of small consumers in favor of the big supermarket, corruption, et cetera, leading to torture and encouraging the children between 3 and 6 to work in the mines, et cetera. You say, okay, we're in front of this product. Is the information accessible? Is it transparent? Yes or no? And once you've got the information, you don't necessarily make an enlightened choice if you have the information. And that's the whole issue of whether you actually change your ideas into action. And honestly, no one wants to choose when they go back to school. No one wants to have to choose between a bag that's made by a child against a bag for their child. And it's a very difficult choice for the consumer. And we need to say that if the consumer tomorrow only had choice between responsible products, all products that are responsible, which means we're not going to push them to have to choose. We're going to propose products which have different prices, but which are all certified and all recognized, whatever type of recognition that they have. They have economic and they have sustainable economic and environmental qualities. And our position, we could discuss whether you agree or not. So we want to push the companies to take hold of their responsibilities, because the figures show today in the studies, for example, meaning 28% only of the brands take into consideration improvements of the quality of life of their consumers. What's happened to the other 32%? This could question these brands that are not far to the 28%. And there's a real question concerning the company's responsibility, which we need to take up on different subjects. For example, what product are we proposing? What mission do we give ourselves as a group or a structure, a commercial structure? And what are we proposing as a product to apply in an exemplary way, our mission and our vision? And we have 78% of the opinion leaders who believe that companies must propose responsible products to replace traditional products. So there is this kind of top-down awareness, and how can we put that into terms of products and services. We also want to make sustainable development just like the icing on the cake. or just a little green range with three or four leading products that don't really develop and there's no marketing campaign apart from saying, okay, they're green. What we want to try and do is to make sustainable development part of the value offer of the company. And to do this, we have different examples. You can see the tennis shoes. You know these tennis shoes here, the V Vision? Why do you know about them? What is the argument which has made you remember the Veja brand? The name or?
Coton bio.
Is it organic cotton? Yes, organic, environmental, ethical. So you already know the brand's commitment for their product. But it's actually funny because Veja doesn't just say that these shoes, tennis shoes, are environmental. No, what they want to put forward is that they're styled. They have a good style. They're just like Nike or whatever. And then the other thing is to how to position the R&D, the raw materials, and that's where the company chose the sustainability, yes. But it wasn't their first choice, their first target. Their first target was to be stylish. Now, what we want to propose is to switch from a marketing of the supply to a marketing of demand to a marketing of the supply, because we don't just change. We don't change consumers. We only change consumers if we change the products we sell them. So we have to find a balance between consumers and supply. Between demand and supply. And then we see from the Avas research, the marketing consumers, for 93% of brands that exist, consumers wouldn't care if these brands didn't exist. So we see that 30% brands are considered as improving the quality of life of their consumers. So for the left 32% and 28% left, you know, if they think that if 93% of the brands didn't exist tomorrow, if the consumers wouldn't care, that's a bit alarming, isn't it? So to illustrate everything I've said, I'll give you an example, because there's nothing best than an example. There's nothing more eloquent than examples. So we reviewed best practices, and we hope next practices that will inspire most of you of foreign and French companies that have decided to use new levers, reduce the supply, to open it to responsible supply, access to product, in easy access to product, to orient to the choice of consumers. IKEA, you may have seen this lately. They boost their sustainable commitments. By 2020, they want to become 100% sustainable cotton, come from a Better Cotton Initiative, 100% lead. This is already effective in their store. IKEA only sells stairs. 100% FSC, because they don't always look at the basic material. And so there will be 100% FSC by 2020. And somehow, a business which is has not so much impact for IKEA, but its restaurants, the famous Swedish balls, etc. Well, concerning fish, IKEA by 2020 commits itself to only propose 100% MSC. Another example, Botanic, it's a garden store, has banned pesticides, but Botanic committed itself 10 years ago on it. So they did it when nobody commented this. Even EU rules didn't push businesses to eliminate these products from their range. So in 2007, Botanic decided to eliminate the phyto health products, pesticides, and by eliminating pesticides from their self-service, they put their product under key, so this salesperson had to go and look for it. And when the client had to ask for the pesticide, this human relationship enabled to raise awareness among consumers, because the salesperson was able to explain to the client that there were other alternatives to the pesticides. So they presented the use, the ingredients used, the difference with pesticides, and often consumers switched to this natural alternative instead of choosing pesticides. This was the first stage. Then the second stage is that Botanic just erased this products from their supply. Interestingly enough, and no other industrial, maybe Leclerc in 2012 eliminated in Brittany for the to start off, and then in the rest of France their pesticides. But apart from this example, no other retailer has bet on suppressing these products, and it wasn't costless, because these pesticides were quite a good deal of their sales. So they lost quite a percentage in their turnover, but they rebalanced their turnover by offering more sustainable products for environmentally speaking. And interestingly enough, today the EU rule plans on forbidding any of these products by 2020. So the only ones ready for these recommendations is Botanic. So it's funny how public authorities follow the industrials' commitments or consumers' wishes. And they actually take into account these changes in attitudes. So not only does the demand change, but also the change of supply in the supply may influence also changes in the rule. Now, abroad, CVS is an American business. It's a close by a store that sells drugs. Also, dry food like junk food, chips, candies, etc. Also, cosmetics. It's a bit of a mixed store. See, we don't really have that in France. And CVS decided a few years ago to suppress tobacco from their sales. You know, it was on the one side they sell cigarette packs, but on the other hand they sell drugs, anti-nicotine patches. So in terms of positioning of the brand and value position, one a consumer may wonder about this business. So they decided to take tobacco away from their shelves, but they decided to supply something else. So CVS decided to give a support, to offer support programs to their consumers to stop tobacco consumption. And this was also consistent for CVS, because tobacco at US level represented about $2 to $3 billion of CVS turnover. But eventually, by replacing this product with a support program and also working on their food supply, they are offering more and more fresh products and also organic products to substitute for the chips packs, especially the little chefs at the cashiers, which are more of a compulsive purchases. Now they replace it with dry fruits and dry nuts and nuts, so that it's a healthier supply for consumers. And then back to France. Maybe you've seen that nowadays eggs are a star of the selective of the positive choice. Monoprix has eliminated the eggs raised in cage, and now it's only they only sell free-range eggs. Now they went even further by replacing eggs raised in cage by free-range eggs, and also they've done it the same for all their MDD, their non-MDD products, like gourmet products, pasta made with free-range eggs. So the supply is being restructured in depth so that consumers can only make virtuous choices. And we'll get back to that concept later on. This is not a French, just a French trend. Also, Colruyt, a Belgian retailer, has suppressed the non-free-range eggs in their range. Walmart, also in the U.S., is committing to do 0% caged hen eggs for 2025. Actually, it's quite hard in the U.S. because most eggs are raised in cage nowadays. So they'll have to. It will take longer for them to get free-range eggs. So Walmart made a good commitment with that. Also, it rose in the UK is committing to it, as well as McDonald's in France, who's using now free-range eggs. Still, retailers, the Plan B for Marks and Spencer. Have you heard of the Plan E, A for Marks and Spencer's? So, again, a question, how did you hear about it? And what's the key message that you keep from this A plan for Marks and Spencer? A plan. Key message, take into account the impact one may have on the planet, especially on deliveries, apparently. Thank you very much. Actually, Marks and Spencer called its plan an A plan because they consider that there's no B planet, and therefore they should not wait for 10, 15, 20 years to turn on the engine to switch to go backwards. So Marks and Spencer's aim is to offer 100% of their product by 2020 to be a sustainable development products, whether it's their cotton, their textile, etc. Marks and Spencer's, as you know, is not doing too well now, but yet they are trying to position themselves on the sustainability range so that it switches internal business, because Marks and Spencer in the UK is 0% carbon, it's free carbon or carbon emission, and also they try to implement all kinds of sustainable practices. They want to raise awareness among their workers, and it has to really, so that it really is in the DNA of the company, and it's not just a label on a product that will then have to travel kilometers away. Same thing in France, in Saint-Michel, it's an industrial business. Saint-Michel committed itself to only have free-range eggs for all their products, and it's quite funny because the hen is even part of the logo of Saint-Michel, so it was even more consistent for them to have products that respect animals' well-being, which is a great topic nowadays, and also for farmers, we see that they are having trouble, they have nervous breakdowns. So Saint-Michel committed to help to use free-range eggs, but also for their madeleine, their biscuits, they've committed themselves to use 0% palm oil. So they use alternatives and no preservatives, no additives for in their products. Now, apart from food, let's look at technologies. Philips also has made a disruptive change by the 2020 horizon because by then 70% of their sales of products or operations will present environmental and social benefits for consumers. Today, 2015, Philips had 54% of their supply, which presented social or environmental improvements. So this is this doesn't just concern products and services, but also actions among the within the business, because Philips commits itself to be 100% green concerning their energy. And back to textile, H&M also has been taking the floor more and more on these topics, and especially concerning the sanitary scandals in their plants. So industrials don't just need to be proactive. I mean, they are also reactive because they have to face all these issues with regards to their consumers. So H&M commits to have 100% cotton sourced from a sustainable source. What do they call a sustainable source? A better cotton initiative labeled, and also from equitable trade or fair trade, and also organic recycled and cotton initiative. So these are the levers of the choice editing. I showed you a few examples of what we see in France and abroad. And now let's have a focus on commitments and challenges, and of challenges and perspectives. What does it? What does? What ethical question does that raise? Well, we went to see Alan Knight, who belonged to the Sustainable Development Commission in the UK, and he's worked on choice editing for the government. He explains that positive selection, it helps markets go towards more sustainability without to win hearts and minds in their consumers' minds and minds. Because the arguments to be good for the planet and the birds, it did work. Now it doesn't work anymore. So what are the levers to help consumers change? And well, what can industrials do to reach these consumers today? It's interesting to see that there are levers which really matter. But also, it's good to say that industrials are responsible and should be taken into, and their responsibility should be taken into account to have consumers switch to other types of products. So this, of course, questions the free choice, which is also an ethical question. What if we reduce the supply and reorient it? What's the argument that should make industrials commit to it? I'll take back the quote. It's a bit Alan Knight's quote. It's a bit long, but it's interesting. He said that marketing professionals know that the strongest brands are the ones that limit choice. They pretend that they leave free choice, but too much choice is expensive and it limits consumer. There's 100 washing machine brands, thousands of Apple's types, and of course they don't sell them all. So in the end, the marketeers should help consumers make their choice. And why offer others when you have some which are organic and which are good for health and for the environment? So I wanted to quote this because it explains why reduce. So we say why reduce consumers' choice, but he should be able to choose. But then why should the consumer be the only one to make the choice? And the behavioral economy has proven that the free choice is not really true nowadays. So by limiting consumers' choice, to offer virtuous products instead of offering non-environmental and non-organic products to consumers, well, now we are limiting a consumer's choice. But of course, we should still offer products with several commitments, social commitment, economic commitment, you know, or and sustainable commitment, and then the consumer will have to choose. What should I want? Should I support social mixity, reduce the digital gap? You know, the consumer always have the choice. And so what my Barry from Markets and Spencer says is that consumers wish us to make consumption responsible, simple, and easy, and accountable. And they want industrials to support their choices and explain it and orient it so that they can make them the best choice. So consumers, as studies show, also welcome support and advice. 90% of brands in the study on responsible consumption of brands that and consumer 71% consumers expect retailers to help them make choices, and they expect 90% industrials to help them make the right choices. So this lady Marie-France Corr says the positive selection is an approach that would enable to influence consumption towards more responsible choices, but it's still very paternalistic. So the underlying question is whether this practice is justified, what will be the objective of industrials and of consumers, and is that really doing good? And this is what Marie-France Corr, expert in consumption, is asking. So in the end, the question is whether palliative selection is different from current marketing practices by using behavioral economics to activate even neurobiological levers among consumers to favor the most virtuous choice. So this choice editing, this positive selection helps the consumer towards being more aware of changes, and also helps raise awareness among consumers so that they go towards more sustainable choices. So as a conclusion, we like this sentence: to abandon the tyranny of the where, to join the genius of the end, the or. So it is not, the thing is not to offer something sustainable, environmentally sustainable, or something socially responsible, or something beautiful. You know, it has to be end. It has to include all these concepts. Well, thank you for your attention.